Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 5th June 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and the page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box and the timestamping is also provided in the comment section for the benefit of the mobile phone viewers. On account of Ramzan yesterday, yesterday's video is being published today, but you will certainly receive today's video by today itself. So whatever in this video you hear with respect to today, it means June 5. Today is United Nations World Environment Day. This World Environment Day becomes part of relevant in your syllabus in general issues on environmental ecology, biodiversity and climate change in prelim syllabus, in mains in GS paper 3 in conservation and environmental pollution and degradation. In this area, this topic can be linked, or you can utilize one or two points from here for your mains answer writing. See, the celebration of World Environment Day has begun in the year 1974. Now, it is an annual event conducted every year, you know, organized by United Nations Environment Programme. And every year it is on June 5. The date is very specific, and that is when the World Environment Day is being celebrated. Now, whenever we talk about development of international environmental politics, we start from the year 1972. Now, this is because the first major conference on environmental issues was held in that year with the support of the United Nations. This conference is called as Conference on the Human Environment. This conference began in June 5 of 1972 and concluded on June 16, 1972. It was held in Stockholm in Sweden that year, and therefore it is also called as Stockholm Conference. The same year, 1972, on 15th December, a resolution was adopted by the United Nations General Assembly. This resolution designated June 5 as World Environment Day. Now, you know that this June 5 marks the first day of the Stockholm Conference, landmark Stockholm Conference on Human Environment. The resolution adopted by General Assembly urged the governments and the organizations in the United Nations system to undertake worldwide activities for the preservation and enhancement of environment with a view to deepening the environmental awareness on this June 5 every year. The very purpose of the World Environment Day is to encourage worldwide awareness and action to protect our environment. The very remembrance or the very celebration of the day in itself acts as a platform for action and a global platform for public outreach. Now, it is called as the People's Day, for the people to do something to take care of Mother Earth. That something can be, you know, at the local level or at the national level or global level, and it could be either by a person on his or her own, by individually or collectively by a team or a group. Now, every year, this day is organized around a particular theme. Now, this theme gives importance to a particularly pressing environmental concern at that time. Now, if you see last year, it was to beat plastic pollution. Now, this year's theme is air pollution. And every World Environmental Day has a different host country for the official celebrations of this United Nations event. Now, this also provides an opportunity for the host country to highlight the environmental challenges it faces, and also it could highlight the worldwide supports and efforts the particular host country receives to address these challenges it faces. The host of this year's World Environment Day event is China. Now, very importantly, last year, 2018, the host was India. Now let us move on to the analysis of news articles. Now, this article is an open editorial with respect to better implementation of Right to Education Act. Now, this article will be relevant in prelim syllabus under public policy in Indian polity and in social and sustainable development, inclusion and also in social sector initiatives. And the discussion can also be linked to main syllabus in GS Paper 2 in Functions and Responsibilities of the Union and the States, Issues and Challenges Pertaining to the Federal Structure and Finances up to Local Levels and Challenges Therewith. Also in Government Policies and Interventions for Development in Various Sectors and Issues Arising Out of the Policy Design and the Implementation. And Welfare Schemes for Vulnerable Sections of the Population by the Center and the States and the Performance of these Schemes. And Issues Relating to Development and Management of Social Sector Relating to Education or Social Sector Services Relating to Education. Now, the author in this article discusses about some of the features of Right to Education Act with respect to inclusion or having the inclusive agenda in private schools or unaided schools that does not receive any aid from the government. Now, the right to education was made a fundamental right in India, and this was done through an amendment to the Indian Constitution. Right to education was made a fundamental right by way of the 86th Constitutional Amendment Act of 2002. You know, this constitutional amendment inserted Article 21 capital A into the Indian Constitution. Now, this article reads like the state shall provide free and compulsory education to all children of the age of 6 to 14 years in such manner as the state may by law determine. So this Article 21 capital A provides way for compulsory education to children of this age group of 6 to 14 years. And we have the Right to Education Act 2009 to provide guidelines and to enable the fundamental right to education, Article 21 capital A. The author states that the implementation of this act has been The author states that the implementation of this right to education has been a challenge for most of the states. Now, we should know that the state governments have discretion to decide on various matters, you know, how the act is to be implemented in their state jurisdiction under this act rules and some of the regulations with respect to RTE. Authors state that the Right to Education Act of our country has many similarities to the Education Act of United States of America. The act or the legislation in the United States is called as No Child Left Behind Act. The similarities are in school accountability, assessment standards and teacher training. If you see Indian Act and their act, you can see in these areas we could find similar provisions or similar understanding. So as we saw earlier, that states have some discretions or freedom in deciding the course of implementation. Even United States also has the similar provisions with respect to the federal units. Now then the authors come to the main section that deals with private schools. Here when we in the context of this article, private schools mean only unaided schools, that means schools that do not receive any aid or grants from the appropriate government, and for also the specified category schools. These are the two schools that come into the ambit of this article discussion when we talk about private schools, because the article relies on Section 12, Subsection 1, Clause C of the Right to Education Act. The Section 12, Subsection 1, Clause C of RTE Act deals with two types of schools, that is specified category schools and unaided schools, are the schools that does not receive any aid or grant from appropriate governments. Now this particular provision, Section 12(1)(c) of RTE Act, mandates that these private schools and specified category schools has to allocate 25% of the seats to the children from weaker sections and disadvantaged group in the neighborhood. Now, according to the author, this provision does not include minority schools. Now, the specified category schools means Kendra Vidyalaya, Navodaya Vidyalaya, Sainik schools and other similar schools. When we talk about weaker section, children belonging to weaker section, this means children of parent or guardian whose annual income is lower than the minimum limit specified by a appropriate government. In some state governments, it could be the annual income limit could be 2 lakh. know, in another state, there could be a similar provision. So this is how the definition is going for the children belonging to weaker section. Now coming to children from disadvantaged group, now this means children belonging to scheduled caste, the scheduled tribes, the socially and educationally backward classes, right? Now the definition of disadvantaged group also includes social disadvantages, cultural disadvantages, economical, geographical, linguistic disadvantages, and disadvantages because of gender and other factors also. Now we know very well crafted definitions, but how far it is implemented, it's totally different picture. Now when the private schools allocate and give admission in this 25% of their seats under this section 12(1)(c), the state governments will reimburse the schools for the costs that were borne by this private schools in allocating this 25% of the seats. Now it will be reimbursed on timely basis, and the amount will be determined based on the appropriate state governments in their rules. Now one of the significant improvement in the governance mechanism with respect to Right to Education Act is that the admission system has been now made online. Now this has led to transparency in many states of our country. RTE rules in several state governments also state that unfilled seats during academic year admissions can be filled again in the month of September. But so far, the state governments have no clear and no visible public announcements regarding this matter. Now, in this discussion, the authors give example of Tamil Nadu regarding the implementation process. They state that Tamil Nadu has always been at the forefront or at the leading position regarding the educational progress in our country. Now they say it is clear that Tamil Nadu has made certain strides, meaning some decisive steps of progress have been made in the implementation with respect to section 12(1)(c) of this act. Because the state government has widened the ambit of disadvantaged sections, you know, that is mentioned in section 12(1)(c), because the state government has included the HIV positive children and transgenders along with the scheduled castes, the scheduled tribes, and the physically challenged persons in the disadvantaged group definition. Now this is a commendable decision or a laudable decision, as many vulnerable children will be benefited from this. Now this also shows the commitment from the state that it will not discriminate and it respects the third gender. And next, the state has created a centralized database where people can access all the matriculation schools that lie within 1 kilometer of their residence. Now the act mentions these schools as neighborhood schools. See, when we say neighborhood school, it means the nearest primary or the nearest upper primary school within prescribed walking distance from the child's residence. See, under RTE rules of different state governments, you know, for most of the states we can see for children in class 1 to 5, a school to approach has to be within a walking distance of 1 kilometer of the neighborhood. And for classes 6 to 8, it is 3 kilometers. Now this neighborhood school concept relates to availability of a school within safe and accessible distance from the habitation or living place of a child. You know, a child cannot be made to walk more than a certain kilometer just for the access of school. So this neighborhood school concept is based on this safe and accessible distance principle. Now if you look at the act, the very legislation does not define the distance limits of neighborhood schools, rather because it requires the appropriate state governments to notify such limits or area in their RTE rules. If one carefully look at the distance norms given by the central government in the model RTE rules circulated to the state governments, it states 1 kilometer for classes 1 to 5 and 3 kilometers for children in classes 6 to 8. And the model RTE rules that is circulated provides provision for relaxation of norms with respect to places with difficult terrain, you know, where there might be risk of landslides, floods, you know, lack of road infrastructure. See, some in general, we could see when there is danger for the young children to go to the school from their houses, such relaxation has to be made, mandates the, you know, gives such relaxation has to be made by the appropriate state governments. That is what highlighted in the model rules circulated to the states. Now, one another notification that has been issued by Tamil Nadu government with respect to RTE implementation is that it has made efforts to bring all schools affiliated to boards other than state board under the control of the director of school education for the implementation of RTE. Authors also mention some issues with respect to RTE implementation. One of the main concerns is the absence of several CBSE schools on the school database that is set up by the Tamil Nadu government. Because several parents complain that the system is faulty in identifying nearby private schools or nearby CBSE schools despite the use of geographic information system tagging to these schools. There are also financial problems because we find many schools collect money from the disadvantaged children or children belonging to weaker sections for textbooks and uniform. Now, actually, the state government provides fund for these schools for the textbook and uniform for these children. But we find problems such as schools directly collecting money for directly from the children for textbook and uniform. Now, there is one problem. This is happening because the central government does not release funds in the right time. A major problem is the process of admission under Section 12(1)(c). The authors mention it is far from perfect. Now, because several schools do not adhere to this 25% quota, as mandated by the legislation, the author states that the private schools have become islands of privileged class because these schools are reluctant even to give this 25% percent opportunity for the children in both weaker sections and disadvantaged group. Now, this problem almost occur every year, and the mandated access to education for the underprivileged children of the society is curtailed because of this. And this can be seen because large numbers of vacancies in several cities in the country can be seen with respect to this 25% opportunity. Now, for instance, if you take Maharashtra, on the last day of admissions under the RTE Act, there were more than 20,000 vacancies. Now, as solutions, the authors say that to conduct an RTE compliance audit for all schools every year by the State Education Department, because this will compel the schools to fill up the vacancies. And whenever a state government is extending an aid to a private school or unaided school, the aid has to be based on the levels of compliance achieved by a particular school. Because if the compliance is less, then the aid should be less, or the aid should be proportionate to the level of compliance by such schools. Now, the author suggests one more option as a solution. That is, if there are continuous violations by these schools, then they have to be penalized and derecognized. And another solution is that every school by themselves should declare that it is complying the RTE Act, RTE rules and regulations, such as with respect to admission procedure, including, you know, deadlines and other things. And these have to be clearly and visibly displayed at the school premises and also online. Now, let's come to the financial problem. See, the center government is supposed to release, up to 70% of the funds for this program to the states, the author state. But the fund is often delayed. An RTA petition has found that in the past 7 years, the Tamil Nadu government has allocated a sum of 368.49 crores, roughly around some 370 crores. Well, the central government has allocated only 27.8 crores, just around some 28 crores under the right to education in the same period. Now, we see one side, the central government is very, enthusiastic with respect to draft national education policy and other, programs, Samagra Siksha, etc. But we find on other side, the central government has allocated only 28 crore to the state government of Tamil Nadu for the implementation of right to education. Whereas the state government itself has, allocated a sum of 370 crores almost. Now, this leads to financial crunch for the state. But if you look at Section 7 of RTE Act, it states that the central government and the state governments have concurrent responsibility. If you take Schedule 7 of Indian Constitution, you can find education under the concurrent list. Now, this financial problems, this delay in allocation from the central government leads to financial crunch for the state or the shortage of money and resources. We find state governments take money from other programs such as Sarva Siksha Abhiyan, to, you know, reimburse the money to the private schools. We recently, in one of our daily news analysis, we have seen how it was being done with respect to one article, right? And this financial shortage is also extended to the schools, as they will also get the funds in a delayed manner. And they show to the children who come from the weaker section and disadvantaged sections by collecting money for textbook and uniforms. Now, the only solution to this problem on the government side, the author suggests, is that the funds needs to be released in a timely manner, because this will inspire confidence in schools to fill all the vacancies. There have been several grievances with respect to 1 kilometer radius criteria also, particularly for children from class 1 to class 5, because it is 3 kilometer for class 6 to 8. Because with respect to rural areas, see, the rural residents may not have any private schools or, you know, CBSE schools, private CBSE schools in their neighborhood, in their vicinity. And these rural residents will be excluded because of this criteria of 1 kilometer walking distance radius. Therefore, this criteria will eventually widen the rural-urban divide with respect to the access to education. So, author suggests as a solution to take the example of Kerala. Now, the Kerala rules, Kerala RTE rules, are more progressive. They acknowledge terrain limitations, such as, you know, risk of landslides, floods, etc., and also the problems faced by small hamlets where no school exists. So the Kerala state rules in these places relaxes the limit criteria, and the state will also make additional arrangements such as free transportation. And see, for example, there is a hamlet, there is no school in the walking distance of 1 kilometer. Therefore, the state provides residential facilities, hostel facilities for such children in a nearby school. In places where it is difficult to access because of the terrain or the location itself. Now, the authors say this example has to be followed by other states also. Then coming to the window period for the admission process for the RTE Act vacancies in private schools. Now, this is very, very short or very limited or very narrow. That is the time provided to fill up the form and the entire application process and ensuring the admission is very less. Now, this causes many parents to miss the deadline, and we could see thousands of vacancies. There are many vacancies. One reason could be, you know, many parents miss the deadline, and therefore there are thousands of vacancies. And one reason is there is only minimum window period, and therefore many thousands of vacancies. Now, authors suggest a solution. You know, that is, the author suggests a single point window for the admission procedure for all school boards. Now, this should be with computer kiosk to assist parents who may not be able to fill the form online. See, a parent may be taking, a 6 year or 7 year child with them, but the child may not be known to writing. Even the parents could be illiterate. At that point of time, such computer kiosk play a very safe role. Kiosk here means a small structure in a public area that can be used for providing information or guidance or assisting works, you know, or even displaying advertisements with respect to the implementation. Mostly it consists of interactive display screens we can see with the e-governance center also. That is one another example of such kiosk. The authors also say that a mobile application should also be built for feasible implementation of the process, so as to reach to many people. The application should provide live information. The mobile application should provide live information on the number of seats available in each school under this 25% opportunity criteria. Now, the authors conclude that if these solutions are implemented, it will benefit all the classes of society, and we can rise above our social biases. And finally, it will make our children not just better learners, but also better human beings. Displayed mains question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to next news article. Now this editorial talks about the relevance of SAARC. The author suggests that if India revives its engagement with SAARC, it would help address the various interests of the entire South Asian region. This analysis will be helpful in prelims under current events of national and international importance, and in mains GS paper 2 under India and its neighborhood relations, and under bilateral regional groupings and agreements involving India or affecting India's interests. The author states that the Indian government has shown its commitment to its foreign policy strategy of neighborhood first. Now, this has been shown by inviting the leaders of neighboring countries for the second time for the swearing-in ceremony, which was held recently on May 30. And this commitment to the neighborhood first policy will also continue this week when the Prime Minister makes his first visit in this tenure to Maldives and Sri Lanka. Now, it has almost become a tradition for all Indian Prime Ministers in the recent past to visit the neighborhood countries as and when they take charge in the government. Then the author talks about the difference in the Prime Minister's invitation to the swearing-in ceremony in 2014 and in 2019. The first time in 2014, it is to SAARC, that is South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, 8-member SAARC. But in 2019, the leaders of 7-member BIMSTEC was invited. Now, BIMSTEC stands for Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multi-Sectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation. Now, if you talk about SAARC, there are 8 members: Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. SAARC was formed in the year 1985, and Afghanistan joined in the year 2007. Now, when we come to BIMSTEC, or the Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multi-Sectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation, know that it consists of 7 members that surround the Bay of Bengal. These nations are Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Myanmar, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and Thailand. The BIMSTEC was formed in 1997. In 2004, Bhutan and Nepal joined. Now, when you study about two or more similar or regional groupings that operates in a almost similar or overlapping area, try to know how many countries are common in these regional groupings. If you see between BIMSTEC and SAARC, there is an overlap of 5 countries: Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, and Sri Lanka. The author states that the government has changed its stance with respect to extending invitation for swearing-in ceremony by inviting SAARC in 2014, BIMSTEC in 2019. The author states that the government is building the foundations of BIMSTEC over the grave of SAARC, and it's very illogical, and it is also contrary to the founding principles of these organizations, the author says. If you see SAARC as an organization, it reflects the South Asian identity of the countries, both from historical point of view and also from contemporary or in the present times. So it reflects South Asian identity. And the author says SAARC is a naturally made geographical identity. Now, this is because the nations in SAARC, they share more or less almost a common cultural, linguistic, religious, and even entertainment affinity. Now, if you see some of the positive developments of SAARC, particularly it is relevant in the fields of agriculture, education, health, climate change, science and tech, even transport and environment. Author says each of these areas has seen a moderate growth, but a sustainable growth in cooperation. One of the example, if you see from 2010, since the South Asian University began in New Delhi, we can see the number of applicants has been more than doubled within this between 2010 and the present time. But the SAARC's biggest failure is in the political sphere. Now, this is mainly because of India-Pakistan tensions, because if you take SAARC, the heads of state have met only 18 times in last 34 years, since 1985. And very recently, if you see, the last summit was held only in 2014, and it has been already 5 years since the last summit. The last summit was held in Kathmandu, the capital of Nepal. Now, BIMSTEC, the founding principles, we are talking about founding principles. If you see BIMSTEC, the author says it is essentially group of countries situated around Bay of Bengal, and it was formed almost a decade after SAARC. We saw in 1997 it was established. We saw SAARC was formed in 1985. BIMSTEC even did not have a secretariat till 2014. We could say that some progress have made by BIMSTEC in terms of technology or in technical areas. But the leaders of the BIMSTEC nations have held summits only 4 times in last 22 years since 1997. India is highly frustrated over cross-border terrorism that comes from Pakistan. So the author is telling that Indian government is now focusing more, building more on BIMSTEC's potential. The opinion is that BIMSTEC is unlikely to overcome and replace SAARC for a specific reason. Now, this is because if you see the founding principles of BIMSTEC, it states cooperation within BIMSTEC will constitute only an addition to and not be a substitute for bilateral, regional and multilateral cooperation involving the member states. It simply means BIMSTEC is just a value addition to the other means of cooperation existing between the member countries of BIMSTEC. If you see the official literature of BIMSTEC, it describes BIMSTEC as a bridge between South and Southeast Asia and a platform for intra-regional cooperation between SAARC and ASEAN. ASEAN is Association of Southeast Asian Nations. And recently, if you go through newspapers, we could find Nepal and Sri Lanka have also emphasized that BIMSTEC will not be able to replace SAARC. So that means SAARC is relevant and BIMSTEC cannot overtake or, replace SAARC. So based on the specific reasons, based on the founding principles of BIMSTEC and the emphasis given by Nepal and Sri Lanka, the author tells that the SAARC is still relevant and BIMSTEC cannot replace SAARC. Now, with respect to why SAARC is now not functioning or now defunct or now not active, and why is India not ready to engage with SAARC? The first is terrorism that comes from Pakistan. And India often or frequently tells this as a reason for not engaging with SAARC. Now, the non-engagement of India with SAARC has become more relevant, particularly after the 2016 Uri terror attacks. Now, the terror attacks happened in the month of September in Indian soil. And in the year 2016, the SAARC summit was planned to be conducted in Pakistan in the month of November 2016. Because of this Uri terror attack, India announced that it will not attend the SAARC summit that is planned in Pakistan. That is, India will not attend SAARC summit that is planned in Pakistan when the Indian soil is facing the problem of terrorism and the challenges related to it that are planned in Pakistan. And India's stand was also supported at that time by Afghanistan, Bangladesh and Bhutan, because they too stated that they will not attend the summit. So the author concludes that SAARC is more or less now defunct. Now, the second reason is because Pakistan's opposition with respect to some connectivity projects such as motor vehicles agreement, energy sharing proposals and other issues such as South Asia satellite that is offered by India in the SAARC grouping. And Pakistan has also concerns or raised issues with South Asia Free Trade Area Agreement also. Now, even if you see this Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal grouping, such agreements you could see. See, this BBIN grouping has failed to implement the motor vehicles agreement due to opposition from Bhutan. And with respect to cross-border power exchanges, India also have some concerns within this BBIN framework. You see, if this power exchange is signed, then it will allow Bhutan and Nepal to feasibly sell the electricity to countries such as Bangladesh. So even in BBIN, there are some issues with respect to these agreements. But if one has to say that the reason, main reason is Pakistan's opposition to connectivity projects and agreements, it may not be strongly concluded, because we see such and similar issues happening in other forums also. ASEAN-led Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, SAARC, BIMSTEC, we could see that in BBIN framework as well. So the main reason, the strain in India and Pakistan relations is the main problem why India is not ready to engage with SAARC. But India will face very difficult situation when it is likely that either India or Pakistan may host the next Shanghai Cooperation Organization summit. Because if it happens here, both India and Pakistan cannot avoid or skip from attending the SCO summit. Now, India and Pakistan became members of Shanghai Cooperation Organization in the same year, that is in 2017. And if you see China and Russia, we know they are major players in Asia. They are also the founding members of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. And this is also one another reason why China and Russia are openly pushing to facilitate talks between India and Pakistan in the upcoming Shanghai Cooperation Organization Summit that is to be held in this month in Bishkek, Kyrgyz Republic. Now, some suggestions to make sure SAARC is still relevant are: one, you know, the SAARC could adopt the ASEAN minus X formula. Now, the formula is that the members who are unwilling to join the consensus can be allowed to join at a future date, whereas the members who wish to go ahead with connectivity, trade, technology, cooperation agreements within the ASEAN grouping are not stopped from beginning in the earlier date. So such a formula can also be introduced in SAARC also, so that SAARC stays relevant. The role of SAARC is very important because we could see that our neighboring countries such as Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal are increasingly targeted by Chinese government for investment and loans. Now, this is where, you know, SAARC role is necessary. Also, whenever some trade tariffs are imposed by other countries, maybe developed countries, if SAARC is relevant and is active, as an organization, it can oppose trade tariffs together. And they can even demand better terms for the laborers from South Asian region in all over the world. And the potential of SAARC has to be explored together, and it must be allowed to progress naturally. And the political differences between India and Pakistan must be improved so that SAARC stays relevant. Now, these are the opinions of the author. And SAARC still has the potential to become a platform for South Asian interest and shared growth in the South Asian region. Now, in terms of prelims preparation, you focus on the member nations of these regional groupings such as SAARC, BIMSTEC, BBI, and Shanghai Cooperation Organization, etc. And for mains, we found that India is engaging more with BIMSTEC rather than SAARC, and you note the reasons why SAARC is defunct now, and the suggestions given by the author you can inculcate to, you know, suggest when some mains question comes with respect to that. The displayed practice mains question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to next news article. Next. Now there are three news articles with respect to Nipah infections. So the analysis of these articles will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance and in general science. This can be linked to main syllabus under GS paper 2 in issues relating to development of social sector or social services related, that is with respect to health. The first news article states that the Kerala confirms Nipah infection. Now on June 3rd, we saw that a district administration in Kerala has dismissed the Nipah virus infection as rumors. And yesterday we saw that surveillance measures have been put in place, you know, in various health facilities in Kerala to contain and prevent Nipah fever outbreak. And in front page, if you see, news states that four suspected, you know, infections of persons of Nipah fever infections have been quarantined. Now, when we say quarantine, it means, you know, keeping in isolation. And we saw yesterday that the test results with respect to a person, a 23-year-old college student who was suspected to have infected with Nipah virus, has not come. That's what we saw yesterday. But now it has been confirmed that the person is infected. And the test results from the National Institute of Virology, Pune, have shown positive for Nipah infection. Severe arrangements were put in place, and also there were some preparatory medicines were also kept in place so as to handle the outbreak. And the persons with whom the infected persons come into contact, you know, the interacted persons, those who treated them, all are under monitoring and observation, and also in cases that requires isolation, they were also quarantined. And we saw that recently on even on June 3rd analysis, where we clearly detail about the Nipah infection, there is human to human transmission, and that is highly possible. Severe quarantine measures are being taken by the Kerala state government and the appropriate district authorities. The health authorities urge the people not to panic, rather to take precautionary measures to, you know, to prevent the spread of the disease. Outbreak happened last year, it's almost successfully contained with few reported fatalities. Now again, Kerala is affected by the Nipah outbreak. Now let's take it to second news article. See, this news tells that Kerala has started taking steps to stop the spread of this Nipah virus. And there were some six-member team, you know, from various institutes under Union Health Ministry to provide expert opinion and the treatment on tackling this Nipah infection. Even for the last 2 days, training has been carried out for doctors and other healthcare providers and healthcare workers so as to how to proceed with treating the infected persons of Nipah virus. And steps were also made to look into the deaths that are registered in Kerala during last 3 weeks. We are seeing that several surveillance measures are put in place. Now, one of the main purpose is to identify whether there is any unnoticed or unreported infected persons infected by this Nipah virus, and those persons who have not able to conclude as a person infected by Nipah virus but has some symptoms similar to Nipah virus. To identify these persons, they are having severe surveillance measure so as to effectively contain the spread of the infection and also to trace the origin of the fever. The incubation period for this disease is said to be some 14 days. Now, this means from the moment of exposure to the Nipah virus till the exposure of signs and symptoms of the Nipah infection. Now, that duration is 14 days. Even though the incubation period is 14 days, we could see the worldwide practice is to keep the patients or infected persons in isolation or in quarantined conditions for a longer period. So in this news article, you can basically know that Kerala has stepped up surveillance efforts and also efforts were made to trace the origin so as to identify and to properly contain the outbreak, and also the same thing will also be proving helpful to tackle the infections in the future. Now, these are all some of the steps generally taken, to counter any disease outbreak. And you could be asked in an interview or any question, how will be as a district collector, you may react to such outbreaks or such news articles or such information that somewhere some infection has happened, because you can choose not to act like some district collector who dismissed your entire news as rumors, rather to take some proactive action on the matter with various steps like surveillance efforts, bringing on various preparatory medicines efforts, whatever we see will to enrich your overall personality towards the civil services. Now let us move on to third news article with respect to the same issue. See, now this news states that an experimental Ebola cure may also protect against Nipah virus, right? We'll see in detail. Now we know that there is no vaccine or no curative treatment for Nipah infection. Whatever we have is to manage with viral infection, just it, but not effective curative treatment. Now this Nipah virus causes encephalitis and pneumonia, and the fatality rate is around 45% to 70%. If you take WHO, they say 45% to 75%. And this varies with respect to the preparatory arrangements put in place. Now, this means out of 100 persons infected, 70% will die. Now, that is the seriousness. That is why it has been given much importance all across Kerala and also nearby states. Now, there is one current treatment in the experimental stage for Nipah virus infection, that is with the monoclonal antibody. And it has been stated that it was tested during Nipah outbreak in Kozhikode district of Kerala last year. The news states that Ebola virus outbreak is currently underway in Democratic Republic of Congo. There they are testing an antiviral drug named as Remdesivir to the persons infected of Ebola virus. And this antiviral drug Remdesivir was also used for experimental purposes for testing on monkeys. And this drug has been developed by an American biotechnology company called as Gilead Sciences. In the trial with monkeys, first they gave lethal doses of Nipah virus to 8 African green monkeys. Then they gave this antiviral drug to 4 of them. And they found 4 of the monkeys which received this drug survived, and the other 4 that did not get the drug died within some 8 days. So if you see Ebola and Nipah, they belong to different viral families. Ebola belongs to Filoviridae family and Nipah virus belongs to Paramyxoviridae family. But we see this remdesivir drug is found to be effective against both these viral infections. Now it has been said that this antiviral drug is also effective against few other infections as well, like Lassa fever and MERS coronavirus, respiratory syncytial virus. This Lassa fever is defined as acute viral hemorrhagic illness of 2 to 21 days duration seen in West Africa. And when we say about MERS coronavirus, it is Middle East Respiratory Syndrome coronavirus. It's defined as, you know, viral respiratory disease caused by a new type of coronavirus first identified in Saudi Arabia in 2012. And respiratory syncytial virus, it causes acute lower respiratory infection, particularly in infants and young children. It's seen all over the world. See, if you take these viruses, right, the outer shells of all these viruses are very different, but their polymerases are similar. Now, when we say polymerases, we mean genome copying enzyme. Since that is similar, see, we also should note that this antiviral drug that we are discussing with this article, remdesivir, targets these polymerases. Therefore, the drug is effective to able to cure the, it is said that the drug is effective against all these infections, Ebola, Nipah and the other viral infections as well. So that is the reason why the same antiviral drug is found to be effective. Though the outer shells are different, but the polymerases are similar. And with this, we come to the end of these three articles that specifically talk about Nipah virus or Nipah infection. Now let us move on to next news article. Now the next article is about the ranking of India in SDG Gender Index. Now this article is relevant in current events of national importance in prelim syllabus and also in economic and social development. In mains, it can be related under role of women, in GS1 under role of women and the problems and remedies and issues with them. And in main syllabus, it could be related with in GS paper 1 under role of women, the problems, challenges and the remedies. And in GS paper 3, inclusive growth. Now we find that this SDG gender index, sustainable development goal gender index, is being developed or is developed by a partnership named as Equal Measures 2030. Now, you know, the name equal measure means in equal measure for both men and women, right? And this Equal Measures 2030 means it is a independent civil society and private sector led partnership that works for a world where gender equality is achieved and that every girl and woman counts and is counted. Now, this means that participation of women and girls in every process associated with them and also in general. That is why it says where world where every woman counts and is counted. Now, this partnership works to generate data and evidence to guide efforts to reach SDG goals by 2030. The importance of data and evidence is that only when there is data or evidence, then only we can push for policy reforms or national policy. When there is no data or no evidence with respect to various parameters, it is not possible to proceed with the efforts and also to track progress. No data available, no way we can decide on whether there is enough progress made previously based on the previous incidents. Because most of the time in the matters connected with minorities, any minority for that matter, if you take, there won't be enough data to make policy. You take women, you take children, you take transgenders, you ask any question with respect to transgenders, disaggregation of data, nowhere we could find any authenticated source, because most of the surveys or research, particularly by government, has not been conducted. Let's come to SDG Gender Index. See, this article takes this index based on a report published by this Equal Measures 2030 partnership, titled as Harnessing the Power of Data for Gender Equality. Now, the SDG goal number 5, it states that it's titled as Gender Equality. If you read through the targets or goals, whatever in that particular SDG goal number 5, you could not find the term transgender. So it's kind of, you know, ignored or neglected in the drafting of the goal. Now let's come to women. At least see here, SDG goal gives various targets with respect to women and female children. Now we may think that SDG goal number 5 is the only goal that talks about gender equality, but there are almost some 14 sustainable development goals, including the SDG goal number 5, that have great relevance with respect to women and also female children. If you take SDG goal number 1, it talks about eliminating poverty. We should also link SDG goal number 5 with SDG 1. We should know how much women are below poverty line. Now that gender lens we need to apply with every SDG goal. If it is SDG goal number 2 under hunger and nutrition, we should see how much female children are affected by under the problem of undernourishment. How many female children and women are obese? How many women are anemic? You know, this is how you should relate SDG goal 5 with SDG 2. And if you take SDG 3 that deals with health, we can link maternal mortality rate there. And this is how it goes. So almost 14 sustainable development goals have high relevance to women and female children. Now this SDG gender index published by this Equal Measures 2030 partnership, India is ranked at 95 out of 129 countries. Now they have placed India in very poor category because of the less or relatively poor score it has obtained. The score of India is 56.2 out of 100. And it has noted that India has scored better or well in the areas of health, hunger and energy. Now, you know, energy coming under SDG goal number 7, it relates how far women have access to the energy, clean energy, all, you know, conventional energy, etc. And India has performed poorly or had poor scores in areas of partnerships. Now, when we talk about partnerships, partnerships come under SDG goal number 17. Now, here they take how much the government spends for women and how far budget is allocated by the country for the women, and also the transparency of gender statistics. The necessity to cite transparency of gender statistics is, see, whenever there is a report published, you know, in the government, you know, by a government committee or report, and if it says some ground reality, say for example, some situation is very poor, but the government may not publish it, you know, there will be anti-incumbency or there will be lowering of image of the government. So fearing this, the government may not publish it. That's why they include transparency of gender statistics under partnerships of SDG goal 17. And India has also had poor scores with respect to industry, infrastructure and innovation. These are not just industry, infrastructure and innovation. Now they are linking every goal with respect to women. Now women in climate, SDG goal number 13 talks about climate change. Now when they talk about women in climate, they analyze the difference in vulnerability factor between men and women and the representation of women in climate change political process. These are the things they have assessed, and they have found India performed poorly in partnerships, industry, infrastructure and innovation and climate. And if you take best 5 countries, they are from Denmark, Finland, Sweden, Norway and Netherlands. If you see their scores, they have scored from between the range of 85 to 90. No country has crossed or touched even the score of 90. And if 100 means the world has, the particular region has achieved gender equality, and no country has done that. And if you take worst 5 countries, they are Niger, Yemen, Congo, Democratic Republic of Congo and Chad. If you see their scores, you know, range from from 33 to 45, and India's score is 56.2. So this is about this news article. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. Now, this article is about few comments made by Mr. M.S. Swaminathan, the father of Indian Green Revolution, with respect to stubble burning during a screening of a documentary at M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation in Chennai. Now, this article will be relevant in general issues on environmental ecology in prelim syllabus and in mains under environmental pollution. See, first let us know stubble burning. Stubble means crop residues. Stubble burning means burning of crop residues. Now, these crop residues are nothing but stalk and straw when it comes to wheat and paddy. So, after harvesting, whenever farmers do harvesting, that is done by, nowadays harvesting is being carried out by machines. So, after the machines harvest, there will be lot of crop residue left in the land. Now, if the farmers go for manual labor to remove these crop residues, there are significant costs, and also the time consumed is also more, right? Particularly after the paddy harvesting, the farmers in northern India, immediately, particularly in Haryana and Punjab, immediately go for next planting of crops. So they should have time also. So either to remove the crop residue, they should go for mechanized methods, or they should go for manual labor. If they go for manual labor, heavier cost, more time. But if they go for mechanized methods, again it is also for removing crop residue, mechanized methods also adding up to huge costs. To avoid such difficulties, farmers just go with a matchstick and burn the entire residue in the field in a single go. But the problem is that the smoke that comes as a result of the burning in the, particularly in the states of Punjab and Haryana, because of this stubble burning, are carried by winds to almost entire North India, particularly Delhi. There, the smoke add up with suspended particulate matter and add up to the air pollution. And this will have serious implications and damages to human health and environmental health also. Now, one another thing is that when they burn the stubble, right, it also reduces soil nutrients, and therefore it adds up the costs for the farmers for fertilizer or manure in the future. Now, generally when they talk about stubble burning, it raises alarms, more importantly during winter. Now, the reason is that during winter, in the months of October, November, when they carry out paddy harvesting, the farmers go for burning both stalk and straw of paddy crop. Rather, when it was wheat harvesting during the months of March, April, the farmers go for burning only the stalk of the crop residue, right? That is also one of the reasons why during winter stubble burning is a greater issue. One another thing is the climate scenario, the weather scenario, because during winter time the smoke adds up to the existing smog already in the Delhi or northern Indian regions, and that is also one of the reason why during winter the problem of stubble burning is more, and that adds up to air pollution and related health defects with respect to human health and environmental health. Now, this article suggests a farmer friendly solution to the problem. This solution you can add up to your knowledge with respect to solutions to contain stubble burning. We have been seeing several articles with respect to solutions. One of them is having penalties and then creating awareness among farmers, or providing mechanized tools to remove crop residue and at subsidized cost. These are some of the solutions suggested normally. We know that Mr. M.S. Swaminathan is the father of Indian Green Revolution, and if generally they talk, it is a father of Green Revolution, it is Norman Borlaug, right? And he told that the burning of rice straw or the stubble burning leads to severe air pollution in North India. And one solution he suggested is that this rice straw can be enriched with urea and molasses, and this supplemented raw straw with urea or molasses can be used as animal feed. So rather than go for burning, farmer could use this as a, see it from the view of economy. They can sell this for animal feed. So it's a viable alternative to farmers and will also contain or will also prevent air pollution. Now, with this, we come to the end of this article. Next, we'll see few practice questions. Now, the first question Here they have given three statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. Now the first statement is all member nations of BBIN are also member nations of SAARC. Now BBIN stands for Bangladesh, Bhutan, India and Nepal. We know that these four countries are member nations of SAARC also, South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. So the first statement is correct. Now the second statement, India is not a member of SCO, Shanghai Cooperation Organization, but it is a member of BBIN, that is Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal. Now we studied during our analysis that India is a member of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. In fact, both India and Pakistan became members of this Shanghai Cooperation Organization in the year 2017. So the second statement, first part is wrong, therefore the entire statement is wrong. Now the third statement states that all member countries of SAARC are also member nations of BIMSTEC. Now if you take BIMSTEC, you cannot find Afghanistan, Pakistan and Maldives. But if you take SAARC, you can see Maldives, Afghanistan and Pakistan along with India, Sri Lanka and our neighbor countries that are members of SAARC. We cannot say that all member nations of SAARC are also member nations of BIMSTEC. Therefore, the third statement is also wrong. So we have to eliminate 2 and 3. Therefore, we will finally available with option A, 1 only. So the answer for this question is option A, 1 only is correct. The main question in GS2. Now it states the recent developments in India's foreign policy show that India is engaging BIMSTEC instead of SAARC. Do you agree that SAARC still has the potential to become a platform for South Asian interests and shared values? Now if you see, there are two parts or two sections. Now the first is the statement that the recent developments in India's foreign policy showing India's engagement with BIMSTEC instead of SAARC. And second is the opinion-based statement and the answer writing for that. Now, for the first step, you have to give favorable opinion or favorable answer for the statement. Here you can say that, yes, recent policy developments show that India is engaging with BIMSTEC, because if you see the 2019 swearing-in ceremony of India's political leadership, member nations of leaders from member nations of BIMSTEC were invited, not SAARC. Now, in 2014, if you see, it was SAARC that was invited. Now it is not SAARC. And from 2016, India distanced itself from, you know, engaging much with SAARC because of the Uri terrorist attack in 2016 in September. And even because of that, India stated that it will not attend the 19th SAARC summit that is about to happen in Pakistan in November 2016. And you can say that recently, if you see earlier, we saw that BIMSTEC secretariat was not even established for several years. And after 2014, we could see several initiatives with respect to BIMSTEC. And all these signal that India is engaging BIMSTEC instead of SAARC. Now coming to the second part of the question, which is a opinion based question. So it asks whether you agree with that SAARC still has the potential to become a platform for South Asian interests and shared values. You can say a yes or a no, or, you know, answer diplomatically, you know, having a neutral opinion, and also justify and substantiate whatever decision you take. Now, if you agree to the statement, now you can state that the founding principles of SAARC and the relevance it has because of that, and the benefits that it will give because of that, you know, because of, you know, natural aspect, and the various developments it has brought in various fields and the various initiatives it has taken with respect to, one example you can cite is South Asian University in Delhi, and also several other developments that has yielded success for South Asia in global scenario. And if you do not agree this statement, you know, SAARC is not having the potential to become a platform for South Asian interests, you should highlight those points that are necessary for this answering this part. You know, points such as with Pakistan, you know, supporting, acting as a state sponsor for terrorism, or allows some of the entities to operate in its soil against the interests of India. Till that is not stopped, SAARC will not have the potential to become a platform for South Asian interests and shared values. So based on this editorial, you can take this point and add it for your mains answer writing. And for neutral opinion, you could take all these statements and you could say the various ways to improvement and the importance of both SAARC and BIMSTEC rather than having BIMSTEC whenever there is need for BIMSTEC and whenever there is no need for SAARC, not going or leaving SAARC. One can say neutrally that both these agencies are important in their own spheres of interest and it has to be diplomatically maintained in foreign policy relations. The RTE Act recognizes the need for inclusion of weaker sections and explicitly establishes responsibility on all stakeholders to contribute towards this goal. Now, what are the problems in achieving it and suggest some measures to overcome such problems? Now, we have discussed that today with respect to inclusion, particularly of children from weaker sections and disadvantaged group in unaided schools and others, some specific schools we studied with respect to Sainik School, Kendra Vidyalaya, etc. And you can cite Section 12, Subsection 1, Clause C with respect to the need for inclusion of weaker sections, children from weaker sections. Now here it is overall, they generally given the need for inclusion of weaker sections. So you could talk with respect to all schools. You could take inspiration from the points discussed with respect to private schools. And yes, it explicitly establishes responsibility. One can see from Section 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. You could see the responsibility being placed on central government, state government, local authority, and on parents also. So it's the responsibility of parent to admit his or her child or ward in the neighborhood school when they fall under this definition of weaker sections and disadvantaged group. And we saw the various problems in achieving it, and you can suggest the measures that are suggested by the author to overcome these problems. With this, we come to the end of today's the Hindu News analysis. If you like the video, press the like button, comment, share, and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily updates on news analysis.